demand curves come from? Okay, the stork doesn't bring them. Okay, demand curves come from underlying utility maximization, and we'll see that now. Okay, and basically, the way to do this is to return to our example from last time. Your parents gave you $96. Okay, your parents gave you $96. You could buy movies at $8 a pop or pizzas at $16 a pop. So we said last time, if you turn to the next page of the handout, what we said last time is given your utility function, u equals square root of p times m, you would choose a point like A. Okay? If the price of pizzas was 16, the price of movies was 8, your income was 96, you would choose a point like A. Okay? Where you consumed, at point A, you're consuming 6 movies and 3 pizzas. Once again, that should be P on the y-axis. What does that do to the budget constraint? That steepens the budget constraint, moves it inward. Because now, think about your opportunity set. For the same income of $96, you can buy the same number of pizzas you could have before. But now, you're buying fewer movies. Same number of pizzas you could have bought before, but now you can buy fewer movies. So your new budget constraint, you have a new constrained opportunity set with a steeper budget constraint. The slope, instead of being minus a half, is minus 3/4. And let's just, given the preference I wrote, u equals square root of c times m, you should be able to show yourself that you'd now choose a point like B, where you have 3 pizzas, but now only 4 movies. Okay, so you reduce the number of movies, you keep the number of pizzas constant, and you check that we still spent our total budget. Well, 4 times 12 plus 3 times 16 is still $96. So we're still spending our total budget. The marginal rate of substitution, you can compute if you write it down from that utility function, will be minus 3/4, which is the same as the marginal rate of transformation with this new price. So you will choose a point like point B. Okay? Now, let's say instead the price of movies fell from $8 to $6. Well, in that case, your budget constraint would flatten. It would move outwards. Okay? Your opportunity set would expand in that case because effectively you're richer. Your opportunity set expands. You move to BC little 3. Okay? Move to BC little 3. And given those preferences I wrote down, u equals square root of C times M, u squared P times M, I'm sorry, u squared to P times M, you end up choosing point C with the same 3 pizzas, but now 8 movies. And once again, how do we know that's right? Well, first of all, the marginal rate of substitution you can compute will equal the new marginal rate of transformation. Okay? And also, you can see that you spend your entire $96 income. You're still roughly splitting it with 48 on movies and 48 on pizza. Exactly splitting it. So all we've done here is, forget the bottom diagram for a second. All we're doing this top diagram is saying, given your utility is, given your utility is u equals square root of p times m, okay, and given your income and the prices, these are the choices you would make as prices change. Are there questions about that? Now, armed with that, we can draw a demand curve. Because what have we done? We've just given you 3 different prices for movies and 3 different quantities of movies you choose. When the price of movies is 8, that's point A in the middle, you choose 6 movies. Okay? When the price of movies rises to $12, your demand for movies falls, you only choose 4 movies. When the price of movies falls to $6, you choose 8 movies. Thus the demand curve. And we're done. That's where demand curves come from. They just come from utility, constrained utility maximization. You just take your utility function, you maximize it, given the constraint, the budget constraint in place is on you, and boom, you have a demand curve.